Hello, my name is Guy de la Bedoyer, British historian, and this is just another of my occasional videos on things I'm interested in, things I'm working on. Some of you will be aware that at the moment I'm writing a book about Egypt in the 18th dynasty called The Climax of Egypt. It will appear with Little Brown, the publisher, in July 2022. Anyway, what I'm talking about today is a couple of books that I have used during the research for this, and I'm just going to review them, if you like, just the context and general things about it. I'm going to start with Aidan Dodson's Nefertiti, which is published by the American University in Cairo Press, and that was last year that it appeared. It's a very interesting book, a very well illustrated book with stacks of information in it. I'm going to say from the outset that what makes Aidan Dodson's book so good is that he always includes the evidence in considerable detail, that he's illustrated reliefs, statues. He's got, for example, here all of Nefertiti's different variant name forms. And if I just flick on for the next few pages, there is some more information about her reliefs where he's got a drawing, a photograph of the original. And if I just flick on a bit further, that, for example, is a fragmentary relief, which is in the Petrie Museum in London. In fact, I was only looking at it the other day, on which Nefertiti's role as a king, and I'll come on to that later in Akhenaten's reign, becomes very relevant. So it's a fascinating book. Now let's just consider a few things. Put it into context. Nefertiti, she was the queen of Akhenaten, the well-known so-called heretic pharaoh in the 18th dynasty. In a chronological context, we're talking just after the middle of the 14th century BC, at the climax of Egypt's Bronze Age wealth and power. Her origins are largely unknown, but let's just try and put those into a wider context. Akhenaten, who was Amenhotep, and we call him Amenhotep IV when he first became king, was the son of Amenhotep III, about whom I've talked in another lecture on this channel. Amenhotep III was married to a woman called Ti. Now, Ti, who I've also discussed, I'll just put it into context a little bit more briefly. Ti is the most prominent queen so far in the 18th dynasty, and for a commoner who came from a provincial town called Akhmin, just downriver from Thebes, it's quite astonishing the position she took on. She was the daughter of a couple of people called Yua and Thua, the most prominent commoners in the whole of the 18th dynasty. I mean, it is so unusual. The only way I can try and explain it is if you were to take the Duke of Cambridge and the Duchess of Cambridge, and at the point when William becomes king, it would be as if the publicity campaign around the new royal family was all pitched around Kate Middleton's parents, as if that was one on everything. So all the commemorative scarabs that appear, it has not only T, but also the names of her parents. And her father, Ewa, in particular, has a whole litany of extraordinary titles. He's master of this, that and the other. He's the favourite of favourites, blah, blah, blah. He has so many decorations, so many honours. It's bordering on a joke, which of course begs the question, how come this family has become so prominent? Now, one of the theories, and it is only a theory, is that Ewa is in some way related to Mutumwiya. Mutumwiya was Amenhotep III's mother, a lesser wife of Thutmose IV. Now, for him to have become king as the son of a lesser wife is not unprecedented, but it is quite interesting that this woman who had no profile at all during her time as a wife of Thutmose IV is suddenly front of house when Amenhotep III becomes king, probably still as a child. So it makes some sense that she might have brought with her, in the manner, again I've mentioned this on another lecture here, of the Woodvilles during the reign of Edward IV, in which a very high and mighty, up-and-coming, ambitious provincial family sort of imposed themselves on the royal house. Now that explains T. Nefertiti is unmentioned during Amenhotep III's reign. We never learn anything from Nefertiti about her parentage. She also has a sister who was either called Mutbenret or Mutnojmed, and in fact there are other versions of that name. It's because the sister's name is not terribly well recorded, and the hieroglyphs have not necessarily been accurately drawn or photographed. The sister appears on a number of reliefs during Akhenaten's reign. Now, you will probably be aware that Akhenaten and Nefertiti, relatively shortly after they become king and queen, within a few years, they up sticks and they relocate the whole of the Egyptian royal court to a new city, which we call Amarna, or Tel El Amarna, and at the time was called Akhetaten, the horizon of the Aten. And Nefertiti is an exceptionally prominent figure within that. I'll come back to her in just a second. The sister, like Nefertiti, never comes with any information about the parentage. So it's a little bit odd. You've got the Queen Nefertiti and apparently a younger sister, who's there, appears in the tombs of some of the most prominent courtiers at Akhetaten, the new city, and is apparently a regular figure at court. She's shown with a couple of dwarf companions who are with her a lot of the time. But we never learn from either of these women, or probably girls at the time, when this kicks off, we never learn from either of them where they've come from. Now, Queen T, the mother-in-law, we know that she had a brother called Anen, who was quite a senior priest. There's also the question of a man called I. Now, I was much later on to become the king who succeeded Tutankhamun as an older man. But at this stage, during Akhenaten's reign, I is a very prominent official. Now, by this time, Ewa and Thewa, T's parents, are long dead. They're buried in the Valley of the Kings, the supreme privilege. I has a number of the titles that Ewa had. Now, a lot of these jobs, these positions, were hereditary. We know that from other family contexts, in particular in the royal milieu of Egypt at the time. So there is a very good case to be made for suggesting that I is another family member. And because he has these titles, also phonetically, his name is actually quite similar to Ewa's, and they're more similar to each other than they are to a lot of other Egyptian names. So it has long been suggested that perhaps I was Nefertiti's father, and therefore, by extension, he would have to have been Mutnajmet or Mutbenret's father as well. But that is never said. There is never any evidence to that. It is purely circumstantial. All I can say, generally speaking, is that if you jump right on to the younger lady, a mummified body found in a royal cache in the tomb of Amenhotep II, an earlier king, who is now identified by some people to have been Nefertiti, if that's true, and I'm not saying that it is, because it's needless to say in Egypt, as with everything, that's been disputed, but the DNA overlaps would make a lot of sense, and the explanations would be much clearer if these family members were all part of a lot of consanguineous relationships, a lot of cousin marriages, because that's the way you end up with someone like Tutankhamun appearing to be the child of sibling parents, when in fact actually his parents could have been cousins through multiple relationships, and that would help to explain why the body can be genetically related to Tutankhamun that way, and also Nefertiti. But I must emphasise the fact that that evidence is not clear. Now, what Aidan Dodson does in this book, and doesn't mean that you have to agree with him, is that he explains the whole situation with Nefertiti really very well. He does take his own point of view, but by continually citing the evidence and illustrating it, it gives you the basis for forming your own opinions about it. It's also extremely well referenced. And I think that's a mark of a very good type of book, because what you get a lot of in Egyptology is Egyptologists banging their own drums about one particular theory to the expense of everything, dismissing roundly everybody else, basing a whole edifice on what is largely their opinions or interpretations of evidence that is often extremely limited, extremely fragmentary, and often very ambiguous, but presenting it as if somehow they've got the answer. And although what Aidan does here is that he does indeed express his own view, he does it within the context of a very well structured and presented book. I found it very useful. It is, I suppose you could say, in some respects, not entirely for the faint-hearted, because he does go into it in considerable depth with transliterated Egyptian names and other finer details. But, you know, in Egyptology, my experience is that there's a very well-informed lay readership, if you like, who will lap that up. And I certainly benefited a great deal from reading it. If we just look at Nefertiti's broader career, We know that she was absolutely and closely tied up with Akhenaten from the word go, even though we don't know where she came from. And my argument would be that T would never have accepted Nefertiti in that position in the family unless Nefertiti had grown up within the royal circle. I just don't think it's tenable to suggest that she came from nowhere. She must have already been there. I think that's a reasonable supposition. But how she was connected, well, that's another matter. I have explained some of the possibilities. The fact is, though, that she was there. Now, what she proceeds to do is to bear Akhenaten six daughters, and at least one of them, Mediatartan, is around by the time they make that fateful decision to up sticks and move to the new city, because Mediatartan appears with her parents on the great boundary stelae that mark the perimeter of the Akhetaten settlement. And she's added to by Mekhetaten, the second daughter. She appears as an addition to some of those stelae, and then followed by Ankhesenpa'aten, who is going to go on much later to be Tutankhamun's queen as Ankhesen-Amun. It's all built, of course, around the worship of the sun god, the Aten, and what Akhenaten and Nefertiti have done is that they have pushed out Amun-Re. Well, they've kept the Re bit, they're happy with that because that's the sun god, but Amun is pushed right out, and of course that means that that's why Ankhesenpa'aten has to change her name later once that's all over, but that's in the future. So there is this great new city that Akhenaten and Nefertiti preside over. It's essentially, I could almost call it an Artemis theme park. It's an extraordinary place with palaces and senior people's houses, and also very ordinary slums and villages. And right outside there are workers' settlements. And let's get away from any idea of this being some egalitarian fantasy world that Nefertiti and Akhenaten are presiding over. It's not. The workers' graves, which I'll come on to in a little bit more detail later, that they are really very much very strong proof that there's a large workforce here who are experiencing a great deal of physical trauma and also dying very young. Akhenaten and Nefertiti's city, their whole dream is built on the classic Egyptian totalitarian absolutist edifice of a very privileged thin veneer of the elite at the top, and below them all the rest of society who have to pay the price for all of this. And Akhenaten and Nefertiti are shown on reliefs in the tombs there, charging around on their chariots, parading up and down what you might call the Amarna Strip, followed by the officials and everybody else bowing prostrate before them. And that's how it carries on for a number of years. Now, there are some detailed changes and in all of this, but the real crisis comes towards the end of the reign. Akhenaten and Nefertiti are attested as king and queen in the 16th regnal year, and that comes from a quarry where there's a very explicit graffito, actually, which has been only found in recent years. And so we know they were both acting in the capacity of king and queen by that time. The real question then is what happens next. Now, it's a very confused situation, and this is something that in the book Aidan Dodson goes to quite a lot of trouble to try and explain. I mentioned earlier that there is the relief in here, which he talks about, which shows on it, you can't really see it there very well, but this relief happens to show on it that Nefertiti's names have been changed to those of a king. And now, that's a bit of a complicated concept to get your head around, but let me explain it like this. There was no idea of the queen regnant in Egypt. There is their notion of a ruler. Although we call that a king, that's for our convenience. It isn't really king, it's ruler. And so therefore, if a queen is going to take on supreme power as a king, she actually has to call herself a king. And you get that with Sobekneferu in the Middle Kingdom and Hatshepsut in the 18th dynasty. They become male kings, even though they are women. And there's an ambiguity about that because the Egyptians have this idea of a male-female royal composite, which is normally a husband and wife, but can also be combined, as it turns out, with Hatshepsut and Sobekneferu within one person, within the woman. With Akhenaten and Nefertiti, an interesting situation seems to prevail, which is a little bit difficult to understand. It does appear that this mystery figure called Smenkhare, who I talk about in another video on this channel, appears somebody we don't know anything about, really. Don't know his relationship. All we know is that, I've got to tell you, I've looked into the evidence in enormous detail. It is so tenuous. But it does exist. There was somebody called Smenkhare who had a throne name, Ankheperure, who appears to be Akhenaten's co-regent, briefly. Now, some people think that Smenkhare was really a manifestation of Nefertiti. What none of them explain is why Nefertiti should have felt the need to change her name to Smenkhare. And it's a very manufactured sort of name, because it really it's a kind of another version of a throne name taken when you became king rather than a birth name. But the thing about Smenkhare is that not only is he an extremely brief individual, this doesn't explain why Nefertiti would want to adopt a male identity, because Hatshepsut and Sobek Neferu never change their names when they become kings. And just to explain that concept a little bit in another way, if you take Queen Elizabeth of England, Queen Elizabeth I, Elizabeth Tudor, who reigned at the end of the 16th century, queen in her own right, in Egypt, it would be as if Elizabeth had to call herself King Elizabeth of England. That's what the Egyptians required. Whatever happens to Smenkhare, he disappears. Now, I've got to tell you, he's so shadowy a figure that there's no object or possession that's ever been found that is supposed to be his, known to be his. You've got a lot of objects that have Enkeperu Re on them, but what happens is that Nefertiti, and the relief, the little bit of the relief that I just mentioned in this book, it shows you Nefertiti's new names. Nefertiti's new names are Neferneferuat and Nefertiti, and that's a form of name she'd already taken on, and Wayenre, beloved of Wayenre, which is one of Akhenaten's epithets. And she's got the throne name. She's also taken the throne name Ankeperu Re, sometimes Anketkeperu Re, which has feminized it. So she's become a king, a co-regent alongside Akhenaten. And one of the bizarre facets of this is that their eldest daughter, Meriatartin, who had been married to Smenkhare, now becomes their great royal wife. And if that sounds completely bizarro world to you, you have to bear in mind that being a great royal wife is not necessarily the sort of relationship you would expect a husband and wife to be. Daughters could serve in that capacity, and it doesn't mean incest. It means like taking on the first lady role in a formal basis. If you've now got a husband and wife who've become kings, and why that happened is another matter, having a wife in the form of their eldest daughter is a daughter who is therefore taking on some of the formal roles of a queen on the behalf of either a queen who no longer existed, or in addition to the queen, or in this case for Nefertiti, who's now serving as a king. It's all rather peculiar, and of course what we don't really know is exactly what happened to Nefertiti. During this instance, Akhenaten dies. Now, I mentioned earlier that there's this graffito that says that Akhenaten was ruling in his 16th regnal year. You will find in some books them confidently telling you, and I can think of one popular history of Egypt that says very roundly, Akhenaten died in his 17th regnal year following the grape harvest, which is all very poetic. And you'll find that stated in quite a lot of books. Well, when I was in the Petrie Museum the other day, I looked at the evidence for that. It's this. Sorry, it's such a poor photograph. It's a hieratic docket, that's a cursive Egyptian, written on a potsherd found at Amarna. What does it actually say? It says, in the 17th regnal year, honey. And then that's been overlain after that with a new inscription which says, in the first regnal year, wine. Does it say Akhenaten? No. Does it say anybody died? No. What it says is that a honey jar that had been used in the 17th regnal year of a king, who we can surmise was probably Akhenaten, was reused at some later date during the first regnal year of a subsequent king. Who isn't named? That's it. That's the evidence for Akhenaten dying in his 17th regnal year. And I put it to you as an historian, that's no evidence at all. It's a possibility, but it really doesn't tell you anything whatsoever. Now, other than just fielding that without confirming it in any shape or form, where we're left then is that Nefertiti probably carried on ruling on her own briefly and may have overseen Tutankhamun's accession, or who was called Tutankhuaten. And Tutankhuaten may have been her son. Do not know. He never states his parentage. That doesn't prove anything. But unlike previous kings, that's unusual. Kings normally celebrated particularly their mothers. Venerated them. So, for example, Amenhotep III had venerated his mother Mutemwea after he came to the throne. Tutankhamun, Tutankhuaten, as he says to begin with, he never mentions his mother and father. never, never, never. This suggests to me that he is trying to blank them out. And indirectly, I think that supports the contention that Nefertiti was probably his mother. Is she got out of the way? Those who believe the younger lady, that body, those who believe that she is Nefertiti, will argue, have argued, that the body has been violently killed, which is a serious possibility. Okay, now all of this is covered in Aidan Dodson's book. Really interesting. If I just have a flick here, has it got a price on it? I can't remember. I think it was about 30 quid off Amazon. I honestly can't tell you. These prices vary all the time. Now, what I also bought was this, which I'll talk a little bit more briefly. Amarna, A Guide to the Ancient City of Akhetaten. And this is also published by the American University in Cairo Press. Same sort of format. This is 2020. There you are. You can see it. And a picture of one of the temple-like structures in the city. Now, this is not a history of Akhenaten. It's not really a history of Amarna, although it has got a very good summary of the period in here. What this is an absolutely thorough survey of the city itself. For example, some of the finds, those are earring decorations, some of the scarabs. It's got all sorts of bits of information about, well, here we are, for example, at the centre of the city there's one of the palaces and the temples. It's an exploration of the archaeological evidence. For my money, one of the most interesting chapters was all about the workers. The working class, the labourers, the people who had to build this dream, and the recent archaeological work on their graves, which shows how incredibly poor these people were, how brutalised they were, how many of them were children, that they suffered from scurvy, from all sorts of dietary problems and deficiencies. Many of the bodies had evidence of trauma and fractures within them, and most of them appeared to have died under the age of 30. It's actually pretty shocking, really, to appreciate that in contrast with all, you know, the golden glamour, and also this image of having Akhenaten and Nefertiti parading around in the city in their glorious fantasy world dream of their new religion. And what's made Akhetaten, Amarna, such a completely fascinating place, there, for example, there's one of the reliefs of the royal family. There they are enjoying their dream. What's made Akhetaten so fascinating and unique in Egyptian archaeology is that it's a one-period city. So therefore, it was abandoned, and that means that the city is, apart from all the sand that's buried on it, that it's buried under, there is the opportunity to investigate the extent of a city at the height of Egypt's power and wealth. And this is really the only such Egyptian city you can explore that way. So here are two books which I would highly recommend. I found them very useful from my research. They're very interesting. They're extremely well illustrated. They're both well written. Of course, they have imperfections. All books do. And they will have things in them that you don't agree with, some people don't agree with. But all in all, it's a great story. That they're a very useful contribution to the subject. And I think both of them pretty sober. These aren't far out, bonkers world, you know, make it up as you go along, fantasy archaeology. And even where they do express their views, you can find a very good basis for investigating why they say that, or for example, why you might not agree with it. And together they really, there's such different approaches, because this is a thematic exploration of the physical, remains. And it's not just the city, of course, there's also all the tombs. The royal tomb and the tombs of the nobles. And it's the tombs of the nobles, the reliefs on there, that have so much evidence for the top end of life at Akhetaten, including, for example, the fact that Queen Ti had gone with Akhenaten to live there and plays a big part in city life until after the 12th regnal year, a tragic year for the royal family, because it's around just after that time that Mekhetaten, the second daughter, dies and Ti is dead as well. An existential crisis for Akhenaten, that his kind of dream of longevity in this place is abruptly punctured by these family tragedies. All of that is, you'll find that in both these books, particularly the Mekhetaten death, which has all sorts of controversial aspects to it. So there we are. That's two books. I hope you found this interesting. Great contributions to the subject. And if you can get hold of the copy, and I've got no skin in this game at all. No one's telling me to do this. I'm just passing on my experience of buying and reading these books and using them for research.